One of the things that we try to do here at Sci-Fi for Me is feature a number of different creators in the space, whether they're making films, fan films, short movies, feature films, comic books, writing novels, and we try to highlight those people here on this show, and this week is no different. Joining us from Jacksonville, Florida, Luke Stone of Luke Stone Studios. He has a project that just wrapped up funding on Indiegogo. Luke, welcome. Thanks for being here.
Thank you for having me. I really appreciate it.
So the project is called Hybrids, The Killing Field, Parts 1 and 2. Let me throw that up there very quickly here. You're now in demand. You've made your funding. Congratulations, by the way.
Thank you very much.
So what is this book about?
Well, this book is basically ancient aliens and all of those kind of interesting conspiracy theories that we've heard about throughout history meets the Claremont era X-Men, if you will. So it is kind of a conglomeration of those things. It's something I've been working on for a while, and kind of combines those different loves and things that I enjoy in my life. So that's really kind of the quick pitch, you know, the ancient aliens meets Claremont era X-Men, but kind of a deeper dive with it. It is, these are the modern day descendants of what would have been the inspiration for the Greek gods.
Okay.
And so people start developing power seemingly overnight. They don't know why they've got these powers. And someone starts coming around and abducting these individuals. And so we follow a small group of heroes that's trying to find out who is taking them, why are they taking them, where are they taking them. We deal with that in the first arc called Trash Day, which is the first volume of a 3-volume arc. And then in this arc, which is the second volume of that, part 1 and 2, we start finding out that there's a little more going on than just what they had anticipated from the beginning. So it's more than just all these kind of, these ties to these creatures called Nephilim. And in those things that, we start finding out that these hybrid individuals, these powered individuals are being used to power a super weapon. And then they're even being used for more nefarious things. So that's pretty much what we're dealing with here with Hybrids, the Sons of Gods. So.
You mentioned various different things that you're interested in. I'm looking at your Twitter account here. It says husband, father, pastor, comic nerd. And that's not something that you normally see a whole lot in the comic sphere, in the creative space at all.
True.
Does your work as a religious leader, pastor, minister, how much does that inform what you're doing with the comic? Because, it's that whole write what you know thing. Are you bringing in any Christian scholarly elements to this, or you're just, playing in the mythology of ancient Greece?
That's a very good question. And yes. So I, in fact, this story was birthed from a conversation I used to have with one of my close friends who was a pastor, kind of a leader of mine. We would talk a lot about the Genesis chapter 6 verse where the angels or the sons of gods would see the daughters of men. They're interested in those and have babies. And then there's more throughout the Old Testament where you learn of these Nephilim creatures or the giants and these men of renown and all of those kind of what most people kind of have a hard time understanding with it. It's like, what is this? So we would have these kind of strange conversations about that and how they inspired the Greek gods and how there must have been some kind of there's a lot of speculation to it, but there's also a lot of informed study over the course of the years that kind of goes into it. So there is a bit of my Christian worldview that's kind of injected into the story. It's not an overtly Christian story by any means, but it does have some of that. If you've ever had any kind of theological training, you'll notice little pieces and tidbits of that in there where it's like, oh, well, that could overlay. So we're taking what is common known about myth and folklore and legend, those things that you could easily grab and study on your own, and then some of those things that that might overlap with different religious studies and stuff to kind of lay the foundation and history of this world. Even though it's not the main focus of the world, it does help build the world around it.
Well, and that's interesting that you would not necessarily admit to that, but there's a movement among independent comics, especially, complaining about forced perspective in the mainstream comics, DC, Marvel, and that sort of thing. You know, that we frequently hear the refrain, we don't want politics in our comics, or don't be overt with it. No, you know, the message fiction and stuff. Do you have any concerns that people would see Pastor and maybe think, may make the assumption that this is a faith-based message book? What do you say when people are asking you about that?
I've been doing this book now for 5 or 6 years, and so that has always kind of been a concern that kind of hits the beginning. So it's either number one, when I start to talk about my Christian worldview and those kind of things that may influence certain aspects of the story, I think people fear that it's too overtly religious for them, or that it's intended to be that, when it isn't. If anything, there's some allegorical storytelling that takes place. You know, I use, you know, kind of those things that I know to help fuel some of the storytelling in the fiction. And I think that, you know, that works out well. To be honest with you, the most difficult thing that I run into is people that expect it to be or want it to be overtly Christian because of what I do. You know, they're like, well, shouldn't this be more like Christian fiction or things like that? And I have a tendency to have pretty harsh views towards Christian fiction, if you will. I just don't think it's not very quality. You know, but, you know, I believe in good storytelling, like what you'd find from Tolkien or Lewis or, you know, something like that, where you can inject your worldview and the things that you know into an allegorical story.
Right.
And still be able to tell a very good story, but at the same time, it might teach some moral or some thought that, or reflect some thought about your faith in there. So,
you've met your goal. 106 backers. You broke the 4,500 mark. What's the next thing? I'm noticing here as we scroll through here that it says the book is complete, and I see here an action figure, a bunch of different additional perks as part of this, the trading cards and the patches. Where are you in the fulfillment pipeline on this one?
I'm waiting for everything to show up. Everything has been ordered and paid for. We are now just waiting for all the print and physical material to make its way to the door. So we are probably still about a week out from that. And once we do that, we will take this out of in demand and start working on fulfillment. Because right now I have 3 pages left to draw of issue 8. And so the colorist has already started working on, I think he's 2 or 3 pages deep into it already. And so we will be launching issue 8 in probably a month. Once the colors are either finished or near finished, we'll go ahead and launch that campaign. So we're going to be gearing up for the next issue.
So you're writing and drawing this, is that right?
Yeah, that's correct.
Okay. And you mentioned Claremont. And I'm noticing, you know, I'm looking at the artwork here, and my first thought is this feels very much like a 90s book, you know, 90s image or, you know, something like that. Are you drawing from particular influences on the art side of things?
Not really. As far as my influences goes growing up, I really like Mike Zeck. Obviously I read a lot of the, you know, 90s, you know, 1994, I was, you know, 14 years old in the 95, 15. I spent a lot of time in the comic book shop, a lot of time in the comic book shop, especially on Wednesdays during the summer. Every new comic book day, I would be at the store grabbing something. I literally would get on my bike. It was like 2 or 3 blocks away from me. So I would get on my bike and I'd ride over to the comic book shop and I would spend all the money that I made while I was working on comic books and things like that. And then we would, once we were done with the, at the shop, we would figure out whose house we were going to be crashing at that night. And then we'd all get dropped off somewhere and we'd play role-playing games until we passed out from exhaustion. And that was kind of our every Wednesday. And so obviously there's a lot of influence that kind of goes into a person's head around that time. So it wasn't really any one particular influence. It was just kind of that time when I was ingesting comics the most that has influenced my art over time.
Right.
And so I work with a fantastic layout artist who is about the same age as I am, but also has very similar influences and has a similar shape language and that I do when it comes to drawing images. And so it just works out really well. That's just what it is. It's almost like how Johnny Cash, like people say, well, why do you do what you do? It's like, well, I wear black because I don't have any other clothes. I play the way I do because I can't play any better. Like this is just a subconscious, expression of what happens. This is just who I am. So
yeah. Now, do you find yourself as a Christian creator? Do you find yourself challenged when it comes to certain things that you might want to do? Do you have to pull yourself back from certain things, or is it fairly easy to tell a straightforward story with those sensibilities? I mean, you've got those guardrails in place. How much of a challenge is that?
You know, it's to tell the story that I want to tell, I don't feel challenged at all. I have done work for other people or worked with other people, and that's when those guardrails come into place, when it's like, oh, well, I want to write this or I want to do this. Sometimes I just, because of those certain I like how you use the word guardrails, those things that I've put up in my life to say, no, I'm not going to go beyond this point, these kind of boundaries that I won't cross. You know, it sometimes limits me being able to work with other people. But what I found is that if people really want to work with me, they're happy to work within those same boundaries, because those boundaries are really simple. You know, it's just make a really good story. Don't do anything, overtly political unless the story really needs it. And, I don't do sex and nudity.
Right.
You know, there's no point in that in the story, because I want to do an all ages, like at least a teen book where teenagers can read this thing. You know, I want it to where my kids can pick it up. Anyone that, would happen to make their way from my congregation into a comic shop to grab the book, they're going to be able to look at it. And I'm not going to be ashamed of anything that I do. And I'm not going to bring dishonor to anybody in what I do.
Sure.
So,
it's never a good time when the elders are giving you a side eye,
right?
On anything.
But I think that those boundaries and those guardrails are pretty easy to work within. And I find that most people that want to make a good comic are okay with those too. So.
All right. Well, the website, if anybody wants to know more, LukeStoneStudios.com, and that's where you can find samples in the gallery. The project is in demand over at Indiegogo, Hybrids, The Killing Field, Part 1 and 2. And you can find Luke Stone Studios also on Twitter. And I am assuming that those are the three places that are best for anybody that wants to find you. Is there any place else that you want people to go?
Well, the website is the best place for people to go, to the LukeStoneStudios.com. It acts as kind of like a link tree. It does have my Twitter access up there. It has Instagram, YouTube, and things like that. So you can look at all the comic stuff I'm doing. Plus, I have a tendency to do some photography. And so it started out as my photography website. To do things like that, when I started doing photography, I was like, well, I need a website for this stuff. It just eventually just migrated over to where it's all comic stuff now. My tagline on there is even I make comics. But my photography work, I still have my photography galleries up there, and I have some music stuff up there that I've done. And so it could be an interesting place for people to visit if they want to.
All right, and we will put a link to that in our notes. Luke, thanks very much for being here.
It's no problem.
And good luck with all of it. The next book, I'm assuming that you're hard at work on that soon?
Like I said, we've got three more pages to finish of that book. One of those pages will get finished today, and hopefully the other two over the weekend. And so we'll have a pretty solid solid start to there. And then we're starting on book 9 right after that, which is the final book in The Killing Field. So parts 1 through 4 of The Killing Field are well underway. And we're also working right now on writing issue 10. The layout artist has that working on that right now. And I'm scripting 11 and 12 right now as well. So we're going to be finishing up here soon. And unfortunately, crowdfunding works at a slower pace than I do. So those books will be coming out here soon, but they'll be finished before they're ready to crowdfund. So, yeah.
Always a good thing. That makes delivery a little bit easier and faster, and people aren't waiting 8 years for a book. All right.
Exactly.
Luke, thanks very much for being here. Good luck with everything, and we will definitely have you back to talk more on additional projects as things go.
Thank you. You have a great day.
You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV.